Oh, hi everyone. Thanks for joining us today. I'm here with Chris Napier. I'm going to let you introduce yourself, Chris. But just a couple of things before we get started. If you have any questions throughout this webinar, I'm going to open the chat box for everyone and you can put your questions throughout the presentation there. Chris, you're going to present on the science of running. Or more specifically talk about running gait, I think. But I'll let you take over and any questions, just put them in the chat and we'll grab them along the way.
Okay, thanks, Jenny. I'll just open up my presentation here so that everyone can see. Okay, so yeah, today I'm going to talk to you about the science behind the optimal running stride. Some of you may have seen me speak last year at the in-training clinics out in Surrey. So this is a similar presentation. I've updated it with some new research, but I'd like to start with this picture here. And some of you may recognize it or be familiar with the event. This, of course, was the Miracle Mile, which took place in 1954 at the Empire Games, and that's Empire Stadium, which is next to the P&E, and of course is now primarily a turf field soccer venue, but there is still a track that goes around it that is, I believe, 568 meters or something strange like that. I was down there running last week, and it's always amazing to kind of think that that was where these two runners were the first to break 4 minutes for the mile, two runners in the same race, more than 60 years ago now. And the reason I bring this up is because these two runners were very, very different. And that was kind of the beauty of the matchup, that leading up to 1954, they were both trying to break the 4 minute mile. Of course, Bannister was the first one to do it, but as soon as he did it, Landy broke it several times in a row after that. And this was their first matchup. You know, I think when we're talking about the optimal stride, this sort of serves to remind us that there may not be one optimal stride for runners. Landy, of course, was known for his blistering pace, and he would always go out hard and lead from the front and build as much of a lead as possible. And Bannister was known for his deadly kick. And of course, in this race, if you haven't seen it, it's worth going onto YouTube to watch it, because at one point, I think Landy has about almost a 200 meter lead on Bannister, and by the end of the race, Bannister is able to reel him in and pass him on the final corner. So I think it just illustrates that there are many ways to run a race, and we shouldn't get too caught up on there being one perfect stride that we all try to attain. So I will tell you a little bit about myself first. I am a former competitive middle distance runner. So I ran the 800 meters as my primary event through high school and university. Once I sort of wound down my track career, I got hooked on the marathon. And so that's what I've sort of been running ever since. I've run about 10 marathons now, still trying to optimize my marathon race after these many years. I'm a sport physiotherapist. I have a clinic in downtown Vancouver called Restore Physiotherapy, where I treat primarily runners. I also work with Athletics Canada with the distance running crew. I've been to several of the Pan Am and World Cross Country Championships, and I'm off to Japan, fingers crossed, this summer with the team to work with the road events, so the marathon and race walk. I have a PhD in running biomechanics and gait retraining from the Department of Physical Therapy at UBC. And I just completed a postdoctoral fellowship in the School of Mechatronic Systems Engineering at Simon Fraser University. For those who might not be familiar with mechatronic systems engineering, basically that was a fellowship in wearable technology. And I'm currently a clinical assistant professor in the Department of Physical Therapy at UBC, where I teach in the Masters of Physical Therapy program. So there are a number of benefits with running. I probably don't need to preach to the choir too much here. It's probably the most successful sport worldwide. And we know that there is benefits in the prevention of obesity, hypertension, type 2 diabetes, osteoarthritis, respiratory disease, cancer, and disability. And even in low doses, running is associated with a substantial reduction in cardiovascular and all-cause mortality. There may also be some other benefits to running, as this somewhat biased graphic from Mizuno alludes to. But it's also important to know that running's still booming in popularity. And this has been very evident during COVID. Despite the lack of races on the calendar, more and more people are taking to the trails and the roads just to get exercise. And I think once we see the restrictions ease, we're probably going to see another boom in participation in some of the local road running events like the Sun Run. But along with this benefit of health comes a significant risk of injury. If you look in the literature, it's anywhere between 19 and 85% of runners are injured in any sort of training program. Of course, that depends on the injury definition used in those studies, but in the ones that we've run in Vancouver, and I'm sure some of you may have even been in those populations, the injury has been consistently around 30%, and one in two runners are injured every year. So that's still a significant proportion of runners who are dealing with injury all the time. And I think it's important, especially to note with the population in the Sun Run in training clinics, that novice runners are an increased risk of injury. And many of those novice runners don't return to running following injury. So it's really something that we want to try and prevent off the bat. So despite all the research that has been done on running injuries in the last few decades, we still don't really have a good idea of what causes injuries. We do know that that running injuries are multifactorial, though, and that what may cause one injury in one runner may not cause the same injury in another runner. But it's important to kind of note some of the general principles that we're looking at, and what I look at as a physiotherapist when people come in to see me with a running injury. So the number one factor would be training error. And I think most of what we see in terms of errors are increases in volume or increases in intensity that are too rapid for the individual. Ideally, if you're able to maintain or gradually increase your training load over time, then you should be able to avoid injury. Should probably be in air quotes. But what we're really aiming for is this kind of adaptation zone in this graph to the right here. So we're not necessarily looking to undertrain. Certainly, we're not looking to overtrain, as that may cause structural damage and injury. But what we're looking for is to train to the point where we're getting stronger and able to handle more load. And that's really in that orange zone here, that adaptation zone. It is important, though, how we measure training load. We're used to measuring it in volume. So in kilometers or miles per week is probably the most common thing that people will track over time. But it's important to note that if you're only tracking volume and you're not tracking some sort of measure of intensity, you may be masking some of these increases in training load. And what this graph shows here is we've got the orange line is miles per week. And these are the weeks on the bottom here. So over time, you can see that the mileage increases, but there are some dips here where the mileage decreases in what may look like a rest week. But when you actually look at the overall training load or workload, and that's where we maybe multiply volume by intensity, you see that in those weeks where there's lower volume, there's actually a compensatory increase in intensity. And so the overall workload is higher in those weeks. And if we're not tracking that over time, we may be missing some of that. That's not the main topic of my talk today, so I won't go into greater detail on that, but it's something to certainly note and allow your runners to sort of experiment with tracking. So I'll get into the biomechanical risk factors now, because if we're looking for the optimal stride, really what we're looking at there is your biomechanics. And the main categories that we will sort of lump biomechanics into are spatial temporal, kinematic, and kinetic parameters. So spatial temporal parameters that have been linked to running related injuries include things like step frequency and step length. And as well as ground contact time. More specifically, a decrease in step frequency, a lower step frequency or cadence, and an increase in step length have been associated with novice runners and a higher incidence of injury. And these are things like stress fractures, shin splints, knee pain, that sort of thing. Kinematics is talking about joint angles and that sort of thing. And among kinematic parameters, increased hip adduction is one parameter that's been associated with injury. And again, that's things like IT band pain or patellofemoral pain. You can see in the picture on the right here, this is hip adduction. So the knee moving towards the midline during that stance phase. And you can see that hip is moving inwards here. And that's what we describe as hip adduction. If anyone has any questions as we go along, please do ask. If some of the concepts I'm talking about aren't clear, please do ask. I don't have the chat window open here. So Jenny, maybe you can just sort of interrupt me if anyone does have any questions as we go. Another potential risk factor is rear foot eversion, commonly known as pronation. But I will point out that pronation itself is not bad. In fact, it's very necessary. And when we talk about the pronation being a risk factor of injury, it's not necessarily the amount of pronation, but the percentage of your overall pronation that you use. So in other words, having a lot of pronation doesn't mean that you're at increased risk of injury at all. But if you tend to use more of your available pronation range of motion when you run, that may actually increase your injury risk. And then we can talk about kinetic parameters, which are the forces that we experience when we're running. And so these are some more kind of technical terms, but an increase in the average vertical loading rate or the instantaneous vertical loading rate may increase your injury risk. The impact when you first hit the ground, the magnitude of that may increase your injury risk in the vertical direction. And also a study I did during my PhD looked at the braking forces from when you hit the ground may also increase your injury risk. However, the research linking these ground reaction forces and injuries is not really clear cut. So we have to be a little bit careful about drawing these links too strongly. Even in some of the larger studies, the causal link is murky, given the variation in training between individuals. And also the differences between the running populations in these studies. So that brings us to the question of whether there is an optimal stride. So when we talk about the optimal stride and what people might try to attain, commonly things like foot strike are referred to. People wonder if they should run with a rear foot strike or a forefoot strike or somewhere in between. People also talk about cadence or step rate. Often the magic number of 180 steps per minute is thrown around. What about the amount of time that we actually spend in contact with the ground, so our ground contact time? That's also been something that's been related to injury. How much you bounce up and down or vertically oscillate as you run is something that people also talk about trying to reduce. Getting a good forward lean is something that coaches will often point to. Try not to overstride or reach too much with your stride. Of course, we've already talked about pronation. And what about just trying to run naturally? That's another one, which I'm going to talk about next. Often there's sort of this idea that we should try to run as our body is sort of meant to run in nature, or how we've evolved to run. So before we get into that question about running naturally, one way we could look at how our optimal stride should be is to think about what happens when we fatigue. And this was an interesting study. It was done on a group of marathon runners in a marathon race. They used wearable sensors to track their mechanics throughout the race. And what they did was they looked at the last 6 kilometers and compared it to the first 8 kilometers of the marathon. And what they found was that as these runners fatigued at the end of the race, they tended to alter their foot strike pattern. So they tended to run more on their heels. They also demonstrated less peak knee flexion, which means they were landing with a stiffer knee and not bending their knee as much through their stride. That's probably to do with some fatigue of the quads. And they also tended to increase their vertical acceleration in the center mass. So they started bouncing up and down a little bit more, perhaps becoming a little bit more inefficient in their running stride. A few other things that happen when we fatigue is our cadence decreases. And that corresponds with an increase in our step length. And those both lead to a higher ground contact time. So more time spent in contact with the ground. So running naturally, many of you, if not most of you, have probably read this book, Born to Run. Came out around 2008, 2009. And really what this book sort of espoused was this kind of move to a barefoot or more natural running pattern, involving more minimal footwear and a 4 foot strike. Many people after this book came out tried shoes like these, the Vibram Five Fingers, which were meant to mimic a barefoot sort of feel, and people started actually thinking about how they were running. They started thinking about trying to change their stride in ways that corresponded to a more natural or barefoot type stride. Unfortunately, it ended up for Vibram, at least in a bad way. They got sued for making claims that their footwear actually did reduce injury risk, prevented injury, and of course that couldn't be proven. And certainly clinically, what I saw over those years was perhaps an increase in running injuries, but I think more of a shift in the type of injuries I saw. A lot of people changing to these shoes or changing their stride very suddenly. And when you do that, you're changing where those stresses accumulate in the body. And so I saw a lot of stress fractures of the foot, a lot of injuries to the Achilles, and maybe a shift away of some of the more proximal injuries around the knee and the hip, but certainly an increase in injuries to the foot and ankle. And so it's something to keep in mind that anytime we do make changes, they should be gradual. So were humans born to run? Well, some things to consider are that we don't run in a natural environment, meaning that most of us do tend to run on pavement. At least some of the time. We also spend most of our time in shoes as opposed to walking around bare feet. So I'm talking outside of running. We also don't necessarily train as we were naturally evolved to. You know, I don't think that when we lived back on the savannah, we were necessarily doing interval training or hill training. Of course, there would be times where we started running faster and running up and down hills. But of course, it wouldn't have been as structured as we do now or as regular. So these are things to consider. And I think, you know, we need to think about whether natural is always better or not. And this is sort of something I found that I think explains this sort of fallacy of nature. I'll just read it out quickly, but we've got two people running towards a shelter here from a tornado. One says, "Quick, Billy, the tornado is coming, get into the shelter." Billy says, "No way, I'm gonna expose my body to tornadoes naturally, the way that people have been exposed to tornadoes for thousands of years." His friend says, "Now is not the time, Billy, just get in the cellar." And Billy says, "Storm shelters are just a conspiracy by Big Cellar. They don't care about you. They only want your money. Wake up, sheeple." This is obviously similar to a debate we're having right now around vaccines, of course. And then a few days later, there we are, RIP Billy. He died the way that nature intended. So again, you know, we shouldn't always be striving to keep things natural. You know, I think we don't live in a natural world, and we have to make sure that we're looking at the forces and the training loads that we're putting on our body, and try to consider those in how we prepare and prevent injury. So what about foot strike pattern? Because this is probably the comment or the question I get the most in the clinic when people come to me and ask, should I change my foot strike? And usually it's a question of whether I should change from a rear foot strike to a forefoot strike. So this also goes back to the natural fallacy argument. This probably around the same time that Born to Run came out, a study by Daniel Lieberman at Harvard came out, showing that there's a tribe of Kenyan runners who had never worn shoes, and they all displayed a non-rear foot strike when they ran. And so the idea was that if that's what they did, then that's what we should naturally do. That was sort of the goal. But, you know, it's important to note that they lived in an area that had harder terrain. And so if you were to run on your heel, that probably would hurt. And interestingly, a follow-up study was published a few years later, done on a different habitually barefoot tribe that lived in a different area in Kenya that had softer ground. And they were found to run with a heel strike. And so that argument of sort of what's natural is probably more relative to what your surroundings are. A recent systematic review by a group in Australia looked at the benefits and risks of changing to a forefoot strike pattern. And this is what they found. So from all the research that's been done to date, there's no evidence really supporting one strike pattern being associated with a reduced risk of injury. And so any claims that a forefoot strike is less likely to be injured than a rear foot strike hasn't been shown to date in research. And so what this means is that we shouldn't be recommending changing from a rear foot strike to a forefoot strike to improve running economy. And we also shouldn't be doing it to prevent injury. And what we have found is that actually changing can increase your risk of injury. They found increases in bone marrow edema in the foot, so precursors to stress fracture, as well as risk of pain and injury in the short term, particularly in inexperienced or heavier runners. And so, again, we go back to the kind of novice runners that we might be seeing in the Sunrun clinics. You know, they may actually be at more risk if this is a recommendation that they've received. So their overall recommendation was that considering the lack of evidence to support any improvements in running economy combined with the associated shift in loading profiles, so where those stresses go, Changing foot strike pattern is not recommended for uninjured rear foot strikers. And so that's important to note. There may be situations where it does make sense, but typically that will be in a currently injured runner. And there are some situations like in chronic compartment syndrome where changing from a rear foot strike to a forefoot strike may actually make sense for that person. But broadly speaking, for uninjured runners, it's not something that we want to do.
So can I just ask a question here? So if we have a bunch of our fairly new runners or who's joined a program this year or maybe last year, they kind of keep hearing about the optimal way to land your foot. Often it's mentioned kind of like midfoot. So to clarify what you just went through, would you say that they shouldn't be considered, like if they find that, okay, I'm probably hitting the ground with my heel more, they shouldn't be considering changing anything?
Yeah, absolutely. I wouldn't be thinking about that at all. If we want to think about the foot, I would think about more about where that foot is landing relative to your center of mass. So what I'm talking about there is stride length or overstriding. And so rather than thinking about whether you're landing on your heel or on your forefoot, thinking about where that foot is coming down underneath you, and you don't want it to be reached out in front of you. Of course, that may be associated then with landing on your heel, but you want to think about trying to keep that foot landing more underneath you. So taking shorter strides and landing underneath you. And so that kind of goes into what I'm going to talk about next with increasing cadence, because increasing your cadence or your step rate will correspond with a decrease in your stride length. And that's really where we probably want to target, as opposed to thinking about where we're landing on our foot.
Great, thanks.
Yeah. So what about cadence? So cadence is probably the other most well-known gait retraining intervention. And the other thing that I get asked about a lot. So again, if we want to break things down into performance and injury prevention, which are both important for runners, this study looked at self-selected and optimal running cadence from the perspective of running economy. And what you can see in this graph is running economy, or the oxygen cost per kilometer, is on the y-axis here on the left, and the cadence in strides per minute is on the x-axis here. So these are strides as opposed to steps. A step is the time from your right foot to your left foot. A stride is right foot to right foot. So essentially it's halved. And what you can see here is that in this particular runner, you can see that the self-selected cadence, or the dashed line here. Okay, so we're looking at 82 here. Is lower than the optimal cadence of about 91. And that you can see the difference in the running economy between those two cadences here. Okay, so it's a lower running economy, which is what we're looking for. So for this particular runner, they would have reduced their oxygen cost of running by about 4%. So in other words, very similar to a well-known shoe on the market, by just increasing their cadence by about 10%, which is within that kind of range that we often will aim for. And so overall, what they found in that study was that novice runners tended to run with a stride frequency that was about 8% lower than their optimal stride frequency. Well-trained runners had a smaller decrease, or a smaller discrepancy between their self-selected and their optimum, about 3%, but it was still lower. And so the recommendation was to try to aim to increase the cadence, especially of more novice runners. So changing cadence can improve running economy. We just saw that, but can it prevent injuries? This is a very recent study that just came out about a month ago, looking at US collegiate runners And they were looking at the association of cadence and bone stress injuries, or commonly known as stress fractures. And what they found was that step rate was the strongest predictor out of any of the variables they looked at for bone stress injury risk. And that runners with a higher step rate had a decreased risk of developing a stress fracture. And in fact, what they found was that for every increase of one step per minute, that lowered the risk of stress fracture by 5%. So that means that an increase in 10 steps per minute amounts to about a 50% decrease in injury risk for stress fractures. And stress fractures are one of the most common running injuries that we see, especially again in newer runners who are increasing their volume from lower levels.
Do you have any good kind of advice on, maybe it's coming on a new runner, how to, like, what should they think about when they start increasing their cadence or the step rate?
Yeah, it's coming.
Sorry.
next slide. so this is just to look at what cadence is actually doing when, you know, if we're talking about increasing cadence and it, you know, has these great effects, how is it actually doing that? Well, a number of studies have looked at changes in cadence, so an increase of 5 to 10%, which is sort of the commonly recommended amount, and what that does at the biomechanical level. And so some of the things we see are that hip adduction angle is reduced, only 3 to 4 degrees, which may or may not be significant, but that's a positive thing because we did see that hip adduction, increased hip adduction is related to injuries. It lowers the demand at the glutes by about 10%. It also has a fractionally lower demand at the Achilles tendon, so lowering the forces on the Achilles tendon. Again, Achilles tendinopathy is a very common running injury. I don't have to tell anyone here, I'm sure. It reduces loads at the foot in the arch by about 10%. It also reduces the forces, the braking forces by about 15%. And again, peak braking forces were associated with injury in the study that I did, which looked at novice female runners. So again, a large group of what's in the in-training clinics. Also reduces the vertical ground reaction force loading rates by about 20%. And then about 10% reduction in tibiofemoral contact forces. So that's forces at the knee, in the knee joint itself. And 15 to 20% reductions in the patellofemoral joint. And that is really substantial. And that's in the joint of the kneecap and the knee. Which is a very, very common area of injury in all runners. So common that patellofemoral pain is actually known as runner's knee. So, you know, just a subtle change in cadence can have a large effect globally on the biomechanics of the lower limbs. And that's how we think that it actually decreases injury risk. So, Jenny, to answer your question, how do we increase cadence? Well, what I typically recommend is that runners download a metronome app so they can do that on their phone, and they try to match that metronome beat for the desired cadence. So, for example, if someone runs with a cadence of 160 steps per minute and we want to increase that by 10%, that's going to be an increase of 16 steps per minute. So we set the metronome to 176 and you run with that. On your runs, I recommend practicing on easy runs as opposed to during, you know, structured workouts. I recommend doing it either on a flat, consistent surface just for consistency, or even better on a treadmill. And the reason for that is a treadmill, you can keep the speed the same. And since the goal here is not just increasing cadence, but decreasing step length, you want to make sure that you're not just running faster when you're increasing your cadence. So a treadmill is a great way to keep an eye on that. And if you're running outside, you just want to make sure that you're monitoring your pace closely while you're doing that. And basically what you want to do is gradually remove that metronome feedback over the course of a couple of weeks. And basically, you know, you can start with using it for most of your run and trying to match that, and then slowly taking it away for periods of your run and try and internalize that new rhythm until it becomes part of your natural rhythm. And typically what we do recommend is somewhere in the range of 5 to 10%, which is attainable for most people. I would note that this isn't for everyone. If you already have a cadence that's 180, 190 steps per minute, you're probably not someone that I would recommend increasing your cadence. Clinically, I typically would look at anyone under 170 steps per minute and recommend increasing their cadence. If they're between 170 and 180, there may be reason to, depending. But above that, I typically don't recommend it. There was a study that looked at runners in the UK that had patellofemoral pain, runner's knee. What they did was they recommended a 10% increase in step rate. And the program there was quite simple. So the runners with patellofemoral pain came into the clinic. They had one session of auditory feedback, so that metronome at the desired cadence. And then they were sent away and told to just kind of self-monitor their cadence using their smartwatch over the next 4 weeks. And what they found when they came back in at 4 weeks and 3 months was that they had improved their running mechanics. So some of those abnormal mechanics that were associated with their injury. And they also had decreased pain and improved function at those points. So, certainly this is something I use a lot in injured runners, but we also know that it can be helpful in uninjured runners in terms of preventing injury. So this talk's been mainly about the optimal stride, but I do want to, I don't want to leave without talking about education, because I think especially in this group, you're in a position where you have the ability to offer education to the runners, and this is really important. And we know that tailored education is a very effective way to prevent injuries. And what this means is that runners, and especially novice runners, receive education and feedback from experienced coaches or healthcare providers that really help them make the best decisions regarding their training and injury status. And so one such tailored education program that consisted of a bi-weekly online education program was able to reduce injuries by about 13%. Compared with just a single session of general education. So the Sunrun in training clinic's a great example of how this kind of program can be implemented in the real world. And the run leaders in these clinics are the ones who are able to provide this education directly to the clinic participants. So even if it's just sort of summing up some of the things that you've heard today and be able to provide advice to the runners in these clinics, I think that'll be beneficial in reducing injury rates. So just some of the take-home messages on running form. There really is no optimal stride. There are some principles that we maybe want to go after, but trying to achieve one particular optimal running form is not really realistic. But there are subtle changes that we can use to reduce the injury risk and also to improve performance. In runners, and this can be substantial in the novice running population. But I would note that education is really key, and so your role in training clinics is extremely important. And that is all I have today.
That's awesome. Thank you so much.
I'm happy to answer any questions that anyone might have.
I have, so let's say someone is would like to try and increase their cadence. Would you say it's pretty normal then that they might start feeling like the effort's a lot higher? And then how do they manage that?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, anytime you make a change to your running gait, there will be an increased effort in the short term. And that's because you're changing, there'll be changes in efficiency and that sort of thing. And so I think expectations are key. If you have, if you notice that it's feeling less efficient, that's not unexpected. And so just trying to stick with it over time, and usually within, I would say, a matter of weeks, it should actually feel, much more efficient. And so, again, we know that there are, like, if you do stick with it, there are optimal step length or step rates for runners to reduce their running economy. But those tend to happen after you've adjusted to those new step rates, as opposed to kind of initially right away.
Okay. Did you see the question pop up from Karen? She's wondering if is their cadence is too high.
Yeah, that's a good question. The short answer, we don't know, and it's not something that people necessarily look at as much, because it's less common to have a really high cadence. There is some association with how long your legs are. So you would expect that someone who has longer legs is going to have a lower cadence, and someone who has shorter legs is going to have a higher cadence. And that just, is physics at work. But as far as whether there are associations with having a really high step rate and an injury risk are concerned, I don't think I've seen any studies that have looked at that. Some of the changes that occur when you do run with a higher step rate are that you tend to move more to your forefoot. And that's just because you're landing with your foot much more underneath your center of mass. So if you're changing to that, then you're changing those stresses on the body and potentially increasing the work done at the calf and the Achilles. And so potentially you could be at higher risk of calf and Achilles injuries. But if that's your natural cadence and you've run that way for a long time, then you would have adapted to that in some way. So you're probably less likely to experience that. But I typically recommend, with these changes in cadence, if you're increasing your cadence, to try and do some calf strengthening work as well, just to make sure that your body can accommodate those changes.
Great. Thanks. Anyone else has any questions? Otherwise, I'm going to let you go and have a lunch before. All right. I'll take it that that's it. Thank you so much, Chris, for taking the time. It's been super informative.
Pleasure.
We'll post this video for everyone to view at the end of the week. And if any questions comes up, I'll forward them on to you.
Okay.
All right. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Have a good afternoon.